Coming up on Need to Know, while the work to break public stigma of mental illness in our country continues, there's another issue to address: disparities in mental health care for people of color. The problem and a local solution to the issue. That's next. Also on the show, trauma and mental illness are also plaguing our youth. We'll hear from teens specifically focused on helping other teens not just survive, but find healing and support from traumatic life experiences. Don't miss this important edition of Need to Know starting right now. Most racial and ethnic minority groups have similar or, in some cases, fewer mental health disorders than their white peers. And yet, the consequences of mental illness in minorities may be long-lasting. That's according to the American Psychiatric Association. The disparities in mental health care for racial, ethnic, and religious minorities is real. How is it happening? Why is it happening? And what resources are available right here in our community to help combat it? Joining me to answer those questions and more is Dr. Joe Stankitis, Chief Medical Officer at Your Care Health Plan, and Lanisha Johnson, who is involved in youth skill building and peer services support for Compeer Rochester, and she has her own story to share about mental health care needs and stigmas. And I want to welcome you both for being here. Thank you.
Thank
Great
you.
To be here.
So just to begin, that stat that I read at the beginning from the American Psychiatric Association, I'm going to give this first to you, Joe. It says, most racial ethnic minority groups have the same or fewer mental disorders than whites, but are dealing with long-lasting consequences. Why is that?
Well, a couple of things. One, I don't think a lot of the individuals with mental illness get identified or called out because there's a stigma associated with mental illness. People view it traditionally as being a character flaw or people making bad choices, when in fact, it's a disease. No different than what you deal with diabetes, heart disease, and people are afraid to call it out. Like we're seeing it today with higher and higher rates of suicide. If you take a look at minorities, 70% of African American teens who have depression never get care. And I think part of it is, again, being fearful of asking for help or being able to figure out ways to get the help. And that's a big challenge for us in our community and our society.
So what do we do in terms of, I guess, how are there ways in which we can work to combat breaking down some of these stigmas that exist when it comes to this, in particular for communities of color?
Well, I think a lot of it gets into trying to support community-based organizations out there that are closest to the people on the street, so to speak. Compeer is a wonderful example. They do a lot of work working with people who are struggling with mental illness, and it destigmatizes it because it's people from the community that they're working with. And that's one approach. I think another thing is looking at what we might be able to do to enhance what the school districts are doing insofar as again, encouraging kids if they're feeling lonely, down. It's a normal thing for some people to have that, and it's okay to talk about it. You want to normalize people that are struggling to be able to not feel discriminated against by calling out, I need help. And that's one of the key things that we have to nurture within our community.
Well, Lanisha, as someone who has been on the mental health and wellness journey in your own life, talk to me about a little of what complications did you encounter before you were able to get the proper support and services that you needed?
Well, I think, like, I didn't absolutely seek any type of mental health counseling until, like, my grandmother died, and I think that people even understand that grief can take you to really, like, a mental health breakdown. And And that's something I didn't know coming from my community. So I think it's very good to be instrumental in getting that care as a role model to the people I work with, to my family members. That also breaks the stigma. Just knowing that, you know, it's not about like being diagnosed or taking medications. It's not about thinking you're crazy. It's just about having someone tell you that, hey, this thought is connected to this feeling and this behavior is connected to this feeling or this thought, you know. I think that it should start with those conversations, just knowing that it's not always a diagnosis, it's not always about taking medication. And I think that's where the stigma lies.
Yeah, very good point, very good point. Well, of the many services offered by Your Care, mental health treatment is one. So first, just for people who don't know, what is Your Care and what's your demographic?
Okay, Your Care Health Plan is a not-for-profit, prepaid health services plan where our sole focus is for safety net populations. So we offer a Medicaid managed care, Child Health Plus. We also have a health and recovery plan for the severely mentally ill. And this is a program that really focuses on trying to connect these individuals that have real significant mental illness issues to enhance services from the community and help them recover. Because being mentally ill doesn't mean that you're going to be ill forever or anything like that. People recover and they end up having incredibly productive lives and can do wonderful things. And that's what we want to nurture in that. Our demographic, again, is going to be people that are underserved, Medicaid managed care, and our area of service goes from Western New York here through the Finger Lakes. So this is where we're at, and we're there for the people who really need the care and who need health insurance.
Yeah, and drilling down just a little bit more in terms of the health and recovery plan, I guess, are you able to give a snapshot in terms of what that looks like?
Well, what it looks like is we reach out to individuals who are deemed by the New York State due to their utilization of services, say with the Office of Mental Health Services and substance use disorders, to reach out to them to get them enrolled into the health and recovery plan. Part of it is to also engage them in what they call a health home. This is where there are outreach individuals and care coordinators that are able to go meet with them on an ongoing basis, help them through maneuvering our rather complicated healthcare system.
Yes.
So this is where you need to go for this. We'll help you get to your appointment. You need to get medication. We'll work with you to be able to go to the pharmacy and get it, get you engaged with other community-based groups like CompHere, Mental Health Association, all sorts of resources, and help them really plan out how they can get to recovery, and that's huge.
Lanisha, after the death of your loved one and you hit that moment and you needed help and you needed support, how did that impact you when you were able to get, because you're served by Your Care, how are you able to, I guess let me rephrase it just a little bit, how did that impact you when you made that connection and you got the support that you needed?
I think it's phenomenal. I mean, just having someone to sit with and rescope your life and kind of put things into perspective from their side of just hearing what you went through and just saying, hey, you know, you should have felt like this after this. And, you know, this should have been a downfall after this. And how do we, you know, rescope how to get up from here? And those connections were huge for me. It kind of kept me motivated.
So you're able to see, I guess, the long-term benefits of that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Even today, you know, I tell my kids that, you know, sometimes, you know, the best person to open up to would be your therapist, because they're going to really help you find a way to overcome all those obstacles that you're going through, you know, mentally, emotional, financial. They're the ones who can point you in the right direction of resources. And they also can really help you really set a plan for goals and see those goals through by meeting with that person and having some accountability to yourself, you know. And again, it's not a therapist has the same degree I have. You know, she's not about diagnosing me and she's not about writing medication. So I do tell children that if you do need medications, then it's for the help of it, you know. Mm-hmm. And if you're... I think it's important for us to know that we have to fix ourselves. No one can fix us for us. So when you need help, get the help, you know?
Yeah. I learned about Compeer through this, through preparing for this conversation that we're having today. And it was really interesting to me in terms of just the mentorship component that is offered to individuals who are dealing with a mental health illness. And I'm curious as to how the specific work that you do has also in turn benefited you as well.
I think it's the most important thing that I connect to with working. I worked for DePaul, I worked for St. Joseph Villa, I worked for Hillside. So I've been working in this with people of mental health for over 20 years. I mean, before that, I didn't see myself as having some challenges with mental health. It was like, you know, culture is, if it don't kill you, it only make you stronger, you know. But sometimes you gotta go back in and regas, and that's what therapy does, that's what counseling does. It keeps you stronger, you know. So yeah, I just been working with children and adults all my life with mental health, and my biggest thing is being relatable. They really take to me because I am relatable. I am willing to share experiences. I am willing to share family experiences. I am willing to kind of help them see that nobody's normal. I don't even like that word.
That's a good point. Joe, for people who are watching this and they're thinking, how can I help and support a loved one or a friend who is going through something, what advice would you give to them?
My advice would be, one, don't be judgmental. Okay, be open to hearing out what it is that's troubling them or what they want to talk about. And then to really help work with them to find the approach that would work best for them. One of the key things that I think that what you see with Compeer and everything is that you have peers that have walked in the same shoes that you've had. Mm-hmm. So a lot of folks, particularly those with severe mental illness, there's a huge trust factor insofar as the way that our healthcare system has treated them over the years. And to be able to relate with someone who's been able to work through it and is getting successful in terms of addressing their own needs, mm-hmm. that's huge. And having someone to talk to is important. I mean, this is all, I mean, part of it. As Ms. Johnson has said here, the thing is it's being able to discuss what you like to be doing. It isn't just simply the medications. Uh-huh. They're helpful, but you need to be able to deal with your outside world, what you gotta deal with on a day-to-day basis.
Well, we have to close for now, but a special thank you to my guests for weighing in on this issue. So you can learn more about Your Care Health Plan by simply going to yourcarehealthplan.com. And if you're interested in connecting with a peer mentor focused on mental health, go to compeerrochester.org. Half of all chronic mental illness begins by age 14, and more than two-thirds of young people report experiencing at least one traumatic event by the age of 16. There are dire consequences to these numbers if they're not addressed. As researchers point out, untreated traumatic stress and mental health can lead to school dropouts, suicide, and more. For these reasons and others, a number of teens in Rochester are fighting back against these statistics to help their peers not only develop the skills they need to survive, but to also provide them with the means to heal. The teens are youth organizers with Rochester's Teen Empowerment, and they're hosting a series of workshops this summer for teens by teens, addressing trauma and mental health. Joining me at the desk to dig in even more are youth organizers Alexis Clark, Eric Wilson, and Aliana Judice. And I want to thank you all for being here. I appreciate it. So just to begin, I'm curious about how the idea developed to do these workshops really focused on trauma. So Eric, tell me, how did it begin?
Really, it was just, we know it was something that needed to be covered. And like even throughout the year as a youth organizer, we talked about mental health and how serious it was. So then we got basically the real idea to just start like really doing workshops because we couldn't focus it as much as we wanted to throughout the year. So we went throughout the summer, just started training, learning tools and everything, and started working with more youth.
So I think that it would be beneficial for our viewers who are tuning in to understand exactly what trauma looks like for some teens in our community. We've talked about it before on the program, but I think sometimes people don't have a really clear picture as to what that means. So how would you explain it? What have some teens shared with you? What can you share about that? Alexis?
Well, the first day of the workshop, we had we always do warm-up questions. Okay, so a lot of people shared their stories, and some people said they have trauma because their dad left at a young age, their mom was never there, the basic stuff that we go through, people didn't grow up with the type of stuff that other people had, people said I didn't have food and stuff like that, so. We was basically just giving them tools and stuff to just help them work on their trauma instead. A lot of people have bad coping methods. So we was trying to give them breathing exercises that we worked on, and
It's interesting that you describe them as basic, because you said these are basic things that young people are dealing with, but what people need to understand is that there are consequences, there are effects. These things impact us in a variety of different ways. Aliana, did you want to jump in and add anything else in terms of what trauma looks like?
I genuinely think that is different for everybody, especially considering what you went through and what you've been through. And like you said, it can result in suicide and dropping out and reverting to drugs and a lot of stuff like that. From what I've learned from actually sitting with all these kids and talking about their traumas and what they go through and a lot of stuff, it really just depends on the person. Some people can start smoking weed, some people can dive even deeper than that and do ecstasy and cocaine and Xanax, whatever it is. But some people do write, and some people do yoga and actually try breathing and different stuff.
To help them to cope.
Right, yeah. Wow. So I think it's just specific to the person and mm-hmm. what you're going through and how bad your experience was or how bad the trauma was. I wouldn't say any trauma is bad or any trauma is worse than others, because all trauma is just terrible.
It's trauma, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. All trauma can affect you in a million ways. It just depends on who you are as a person and how you cope.
In terms of the workshops and when young people are sharing their stories, are there symptoms? Are there symptoms, signals, ways to be able to tell, if one of your peers is dealing with something that could be the result of a traumatic experience? Eric?
It's normally hard. You mainly have to get them to open up to you, because not a lot of people want to talk about experiences like that, so they normally just try to forget about it themselves. But by bringing it up, doing warm-up questions and everything, it gets everybody comfortable in the room to be able to really start to be able to share with each other. And then we even start doing consensual conversations where people talk one-on-one. So it's a lot easier, because you're not in a big group anymore. You're just face-to-face with one person. And even if you don't know the person like that, you're getting to know them in the conversation. And with concentrics, you don't know how, but you just somehow open up automatically. And then there are symptoms for some people. I know one of my cousins, he won't even go near an area where something happened. So.
Well, I want to get into these workshops even more. I know you've been able to kind of explain what you've been doing, but this is a curriculum that was created by Melanie Funches of the Mental Health Association of Rochester and Dr. Ron K. Lattimore-Tapp of the University of Rochester, worked with all of you and other youth organizers just in terms of the training and preparing and how to host and lead these workshops. You're really pulling off the Band-Aid with what you're doing and saying, it's not enough for us to just talk about it. We need to make sure you're leaving here with skills so you know how to equip yourself and to deal with it long term. So what is happening? You said you talked a little bit, Alexis, about these opening questions. You did too, Eric, just to get people talking and to feel comfortable. What else is taking place in the workshops in particular?
What do you mean?
Just in terms of what does the curriculum look like? What are you teaching other teens?
Oh, we're just teaching them basically we're just telling them because me, I didn't know exactly where to start. I was dealing with my own trauma. So I didn't know what to tell them. I didn't know what to do, Because but that's when Ron K and them, they came in, they helped me to deal with my own stuff, So when we actually had did the agenda and stuff, me and Allie, we decided to say a spoken word poetry. So just get them feeling like, get them comfortable, basically, like, to get them, like, yeah, I'm not the only one dealing with stuff. You know, it's other people out here, other kids out here that's dealing with other stuff, you know, and, like, this is how I cope, you know? This is how I help, like, I forget everything, you know? Yeah. This is how I deal with everything that I've been through when I was younger. So.
Did you want to jump in?
I mean, just to, like, bounce off Lex, like, there was a lot, like, throughout the whole agenda. Like, it was, like, a 2.5-hour session. So we went, like, from a warm-up question to spoken poetry, like, spoken word poetry to interactives and just talking about, like, what actually goes on. And we showed a couple of videos, like, kind of, like, a comparison between, like, what people of color, like, young Black youth go through, like, all across, like, the United States. And it really shows that, like, because, I mean, a lot of people, when you're going through something, like, when you're going through, like, trauma, you think that you're, like, automatically alone. And like Lex said, like, you're really not. Like, everyone goes through stuff. And in the video that we showed particularly, it showed that, like, from, like, Ohio to, like, California to Oakland, like, just, like, all across the United States, like, everyone honestly does go through the same stuff, especially, like, young Black youth, like, whether it's poverty or racism or discrimination or police brutality, like, whatever your trauma is, we guarantee that there is someone else that's going through the same thing, whether, like, whatever it is, especially considering that, like, a lot of young kids here are facing, like, poverty and, you know, like, family issues and money and budgeting and finance. Like, we were just trying, like, our main goal was just to show you that there are other alternatives and there are other stuff to do, yeah, other than just reverting to all the bad stuff, in a sense. Yeah. And we, as a team, can help you. That's, we just, great, have to work together.
So let's talk about that, and just in terms of what are some of the things that you are teaching your peers in these workshops that they can do to cope?
One of them is, like, a tool called Locate, Calculate, Communicate, where, like, you locate where you're feeling stress. Like, some people feel a stomach, neck, back, and then calculate on a scale of 1 to 10, like, how fast is it going up, like, how much are you gonna panic or anything like that. And it communicates just any way you can get it out, and that's nonviolent or anything. Like, you might be able to talk to someone, just, like, walk away, take a break, drink some water, and then stuff like that.
Right. Anything else that you wanna share, just in terms of coping?
Basically, like, they gave us, like, when I was telling you about the tools, exercises, like, they was giving us different, like, ways of breathing and stuff, like, because, like, if you're, like, somewhere and you're, like, and you're feeling something, like, you feeling that trauma and you thinking about stuff, like, you can't, like, just write. You can't just start listening to poetry. Because, you know, like, say if I'm in school, I can't just, like, zone out in class, stop doing my work, and just, like, start writing poetry. So, like, we start, like, so they gave us, like, breathing tools. Like, it's an easy one with the 5 fingers, you know. We could just, like, breathe. So, like, it's like, you don't bother nobody.
Yeah. I'm curious, just in terms of, Alexis, how you said you were dealing with your own trauma when you started working and doing these workshops. Was the process of doing the workshops with some of your peers, did it help you in any way in terms of working through your own trauma?
Yes, because when I first started Teen Empowerment, I started it in, like, October, and I was, like, well, I still am a little shy, but, like, I was, like, very, very shy. And Teen Empowerment just, like, it just opened me up, like, because, like Eric said, the warm-up questions, concentric conversations, like, it just brings people together. Like, it just, you have no choice but to open up, you know? Because, like, I'm telling you about myself, and especially, like, we have different events. So I do spoken word poetry, so, like, me just expressing, like, how I feel and then saying, like, about my past, talking about, like, my mom and talking about my brother and, like, talking about everything that I've been through. Like, I don't know. I just feel like that just make me keep on going, like, you know?
Yeah. I'm curious, just in terms of what you think, how these workshops that you're hosting with Teen Empowerment, how do you think they're offering your peers, or what do you think they're offering your peers that they're not getting in school when it comes to dealing with trauma?
I genuinely think it just gives you somebody to talk to, somebody to rely on. Because, I mean, especially considering, like, how the RCSD is set up, like, a lot of our teachers are mainly, like, white or Caucasian, or they're not, like, of the same ethnicity as us. Like, us being so young, like, we automatically think, if you don't look like me, you don't understand what I'm going through. Like, just stuff like that. And, I mean, there's obviously, like, a huge differentiation in like black and white and Latino, like whatever you are, a lot of people do go through a lot of different stuff. And us being so young and like just some of us being like not 100% like mature or like, you know, just not all like understanding and having the same opportunities. Like we had the opportunity of like working with teen empowerment and being able to go through this and like learning everything that we've learned in the like over the like the past year. But some people don't have the same opportunities as us. And we like just this whole workshop, like we were just trying to show that once again, like you're really not alone. And you have people, like whether it's us, whether it's a friend, like a parent, a counselor, like whatever it is, like we can show you that resources are necessary and that we can be one of the resources that you have.
It's interesting because you've really emphasized the importance of communicating and talking. I know psychologists have said the act of talking about trauma can help in terms of that healing process. So I want to know, Eric, after the workshops are all said and done, what type of reaction are you hearing from other teens that were a part of it? How are they responding? What type of feedback have you been getting?
I've been getting positive feedback for the most part, and like a lot of people have saying like they didn't expect, like some people didn't expect what they were walking into, like they didn't know what was going on at all, but they know, like they said they felt better automatically about the situation that happened, but some people were like it's still gonna take some more time, and then that's when I'm like offering them the tools again that they can use, and then just like Ali said, just having someone be there to talk to, and I think it's even better that it's youth being able to talk to youth instead of just having them to have to talk to an adult or anything, because we're going to automatically be able to understand a lot better than adults.
Yeah, absolutely. Anyone else want to jump in on that? Just in terms of the reactions you're hearing?
Oh, no, I wanted to jump in back on the question that
you
asked Allie.
Yeah, go for it.
About, like, what we learn in TE but don't get in school. Like,
yes.
I don't know. Like, I learned a lot of stuff from TE that, like, I never learned in school. Like, I learned a lot of stuff in school, like, but, like, I learned the code of conduct, like, and that's what you're supposed to know in school, you know? Like, and I learned, like, a lot of stuff. Like, we went to museums and stuff, like, and I learned more about my history outside of school than I should have. Like, all I learned about in school was slavery. Like, and they never, like, actually taught us about, like, or told us about our past. Like, and I learned that from TE.
Wow. It's an incredible organization, and the work that you're doing with your peers in the community is to be commended. I mean, you really should be. So thank you for what you're doing and for what you're continuing to do with Rochester Youth. So unfortunately, we have to close for now. I always love having youth organizers on the show, so thank you for joining me. And to our viewers who are tuning in right now, if you want to learn more about the Teen Empowerment Trauma Workshops, or if you want to get involved overall with the organization, simply go to teenempowerment.org/Rochester. And that wraps up another edition of Need to Know, Rochester's News Magazine. I'm your host, Helen B. and Judy Hofer. Thank you for joining me tonight and throughout the weekend here on WXXI-TV. And you can also check out all of our shows online at WXXINews.org. Just click on the Need to Know link. Have a great night.